Is there sex discrimination in our public vocational and technical schools? Find out next on Manhattan at Large with Councilmember Miriam Friedlander. The discussion will deal with a report by the school's chancellor, which found schools breaking laws in their admission procedures. Councilmember Friedlander and her guests will also discuss the outcome of a hearing held yesterday based on that report. Now, if you're a parent with a high school age daughter attending the New York City public schools, this program should not be missed. You will be able to call in with your questions and views, so let us hear from you tonight. Just dial 505-6363. That number again is 505-6363. Coming up later, at 9 o'clock, don't forget to watch the documentary short, Vasca, A Country Vacation. It features a group of senior citizens who are given the opportunity to escape the city by attending a summer vacation center. Then join me for a live discussion with Horace Morris, Executive Director of the Greater New York Fund, which is responsible for bringing this videotape to us. But first, a discussion on sex discrimination in our public schools, next on Manhattan at Large, brought to you by the Channel L Working Group.
The following program is brought to you by the Channel L Working Group.
Teachers mostly think that the boys have the ability to do more than girls, and they push us or encourage us to take, you know, the lighter subjects.
But they feel you, a female, you should be able to type.
We're subjected to do light things like light typing. You know, there are a lot of boys in accounting and stuff, but, you know, they call that manly kind of things.
Boys and girls, they both have to take and pass two terms of typing in the beginning.
In my opinion, it seems that a lot of women are more interested in office jobs than in, you know, electricians or stuff that you have to repair.
Because that's the role they've been stereotyped in for so long.
Whatever you enjoy, you should go and do. You shouldn't, if you like to play basketball or sports, play basketball or sports.
I feel the girls are getting a fair shake, yeah.
Because they're going, you know, going for what they want, so.
Good evening. Welcome to Manhattan at Large. I'm Miriam Friedlander, City Councilwoman, Lower Manhattan. How are you all doing tonight? Well, I hope you're doing as well as some of my guests here tonight. They're wonderful people and they've done a big job. We're kind of here to tell you about it. It's all about girls, women, and what happens to them in the educational system. Do they get a fair shake with all that money that we're putting into education? Well, we're going to talk about that in a minute. And I'd like to introduce my guests. We have Walteen here, right?
Yes.
Walteen Grady. I understand this is the third name now?
Truly, yes.
Truly. Okay, wonderful. And she is sex ed coordinator in the Board of Education and has been in the field for a long time doing the work. And then we have Lisa Syron, and she is from a very important organization called FAIR. What does FAIR stand for?
It stands for Full Access and Rights to Education Coalition.
Uh-huh. And that's about getting the young women in there, huh?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
We'll get back to that one. Okay. And then we have Dr. Sandy Weinbaum, and you are director of Access.
Access for Women. Right.
Access for Women. Oh, we're back on the same subject. So we're all talking about the same thing tonight. We had a hearing in my committee on women down at the city council about in 82, 83, because people began to talk to us. Here, all this money goes into the budget for education, and are all the students in the Board of Education, are they all getting a fair shake? Are they all getting the benefit of that money? Lord knows we could use more, but even what's there, what kind of programs are there? So we began to look around, and we had that hearing, and what we found out was very, very serious. The first thing that was shot at us was that the state was coming in saying we were illegal. Lisa, you know about that one, don't you? Because
right,
your organization works with that. How
right.
about that?
Well, to give a little background on that, I would say that FAIR became interested in a fair shake for girls in finding out whether or not they were getting training in vocational programs that would lead to good paying jobs.
Vocational programs.
Right. And there are 21 vocational high schools in New York City, and we started to investigate those schools to find out what programs serve young women and what programs serve young men.
Vocational high schools, originally, weren't those the schools that you got dumped into if you weren't doing so good in school? Right?
It's amazing to think that many people have had that concept, but actually our vocational technical schools are some of the best in the country and provide tremendous training in careers that can lead to jobs that pay quite well.
Oh, if you get the right kind of career. Is that the problem?
Of course. Of course.
So it's no longer a dumping ground. This is very desirable education, from what I can see. Some of the schools you even have to take exams to get into, don't you?
Yes.
Right?
It's a screening process.
There's a screening process?
Yeah.
For what kind of schools?
There are a number of them. I think Lisa's the expert on this. She knows the ones that have the screening process.
Okay. What did you find then, Lisa, in regard to these 21 schools?
There's 21. At that time, there were 21 vocational schools, and we found that at 11 of the schools, they had predominantly male enrollments.
Wait a moment. Let's guess. What did they teach in those schools?
Are you going to guess?
I don't know. You better tell us. Because
not cosmetology.
I bet the audience could tell us what they teach in those schools.
If you think of almost any higher paying occupation that you would learn in a trade or technical school, you would find it at those schools.
Carpenter,
technical electrician, auto mechanic, drafter.
Woodworking, computer programming.
Electronics of all kinds. I mean, that's a big area right now.
Aerodynamics,
right? Uh-huh, all kinds of mechanics and so forth.
Okay. Science. Computer. Anyway, those are the ones.
Right.
That's how many schools?
At 11. In 1979, there were 11.
Were there three others in which they were predominantly women?
There were five others that were actually predominantly women.
And guess what they taught? What did they teach?
All the things that we always see women doing, things like being a nurse or a secretary, sort of those traditional women's occupations.
Cosmetology. Very fancy name for standing on your feet all day and cutting hair, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what else? What was in the other two schools?
In the other schools, they had occupations that had mixed enrollments, both boys and girls, and they were occupations like graphic arts or printing.
I see.
And they tend to be newer occupations, and they don't have such a long history of all male workers or all female workers.
You know, it just occurred to me, I read figures the other day, that about 45% of the women, of the young women who are going into school now, will have to work for a living, or want to work for a living, and have to try and maintain themselves and families and children and things like that. And yet here's the beginning of their early training. So you can either get trained to live on a low income as a secretary or a file clerk, never mind the secretary anymore, or a cosmetologist, or you can get trained for a high paying skilled job, right?
Right, absolutely. In fact, I think a lot of people still think of sort of protecting their daughters and preparing them to become mothers or to look for a husband, and they don't think about the fact that 9 out of 10 young women will work in their lives.
Uh-huh. That big a percentage?
Right.
It's interesting.
And so when you start to think about your daughter working and maybe supporting herself and maybe supporting her family, I think it becomes a lot more important to think about what she's capable of earning in her life.
Uh-huh.
And is she going to be able to support herself?
Well, tell me, why was there such a barrier against their going into the other jobs? Dirty hands?
It's part of it.
Is that an attitude? What would you say, Sandy?
I think that historically there was a lot of opposition against women going into many of the occupations that men were in, and that came from the employers. I think it also came from the men who were actually doing that kind of work.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you would find, going back to the early 20th century, even, for example, within the garment industry, men and women would do separate, totally different things.
That's
now,
right.
The main point was that they were paid approximately half the wages, or 60% of the wages of men.
The women did the sewing, got very little, the men did the cutting.
Exactly.
Very high skills.
And the point was that they were paid 60% of what men earned in those days, and it's precisely the same today. I mean,
we're still getting that same reaction in the public school system where they first start, where you begin to separate the girls from the boys, and you still have, what? You have the books there, yeah, that say the same things?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Jack picked up his lunch pail and went off to work. And Jill picked up her what? Her dirty dishes and went into the kitchen, right? Yeah. So that's still in the books, or the attitudes in the books.
I think some of that is changing a little bit, but I think it's not changing enough to give girls the sense that there are many other possibilities for them. I mean, the books may not be as blatant as they were when I went to school and when Mommy was in the kitchen and Daddy left with his briefcase every day. I mean, they're slightly improved, I think. Right. Realistically, they are. But there's not enough offered to girls. They may think they're going to work, but they'll think they're going to work as a secretary.
As a secretary.
Or a model. Or, I mean, and we've done surveys of high school students through our program, and most of the girls still say four occupations. Nurse, secretary, child care worker, social worker.
That's in a recent period within the year?
Last year. Excepting for the girls who are in some of these special programs, who already are defining themselves in different ways.
In your experience, Walteen, what do you find?
Well, I find a whole range of attitudes out there. I've had some experience in going out in the schools, working with both students and with teachers.
Right.
And there's a whole variety of attitudes, and it's fascinating, really, because we have such a complex city and such a diversity
different
of cultures.
And
so you find kids coming with all kinds of ideas that sometimes are tied to their cultural background, that are sometimes tied to role models that they see. I had a very interesting experience last year in Staten Island, where on a parents' day, a parent came in who reflected the exact opposite image that one traditionally has of what a parent is going to be of a young woman. And she came in with her jeans and this huge ring with keys and cowboy boots, and she had grease under her nails, and she said that she's the one who deals with all the repairs and working on the family car. Well, it's not an accident then that she would come out particularly to discuss the issue of non-traditional career options for her daughter.
But that's a whole new thing that's being projected, that young women not only should but can move into it, and that it's available in the schools. What was it that was found illegal about the school system in reference to discrimination, sexism, sex bias in the school that your group found?
We looked at the facilities in the school, found that the facilities weren't designed to house both male and female students. They were just bathrooms for boys or locker rooms for boys, gym facilities. In the admissions process, a lot of times guidance counselors might suggest to students that it would be more appropriate for a boy to go into this kind of program or a girl to go into cosmetology. And in fact, in some cases, they actually use tests that were biased, that would be more likely to direct boys into one kind of school or girls into another kind of school. Within the school program, we found that sometimes placement, once you get into the school, you may have a choice between a number of different occupations that you could study. So guidance counselors, again, would be more likely to direct girls into the more traditionally female areas. Those are the kinds of issues. And in fact, after we wrote, well, we began to investigate on our own as a private community group, and as a result of some of that work, the State Education Department also investigated the schools and found that they were in non-compliance with federal guidelines on civil rights.
Okay, what are those federal guidelines? Somebody give me a fast shot at it.
Well, they're called Title IX.
Title IX.
The Education Amendments, 1972.
That's official.
And it's as official as you can be. And
right.
Basically, the law was passed on the national level in
it's
the
a
face
federal
of.
Law,
it's
isn't?
A federal level.
Yeah.
In the face of a growing awareness brought about by the burgeoning women's movement of that time of the changed role of women.
And women themselves were demanding the law.
Yes.
And they got it?
They got it, but they could not have gotten it, interestingly enough, without the support of male legislatures, because they're, face it,
there
sex discrimination.
Sex discrimination in
Congress.
We'll shift to that subject some other day. Okay. All righty, let's go. So that law is in effect,
right.
Except I mean, that hasn't been repealed by Reagan yet, has it?
No.
Or the Justice Department hasn't called for it.
People are often concerned about that.
They
in
are.
Fact. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So while we have it, we have to keep it in force and implement
it's very
it.
Important.
So that's the law that we were violating by having discrimination so blatantly. 95% male,
right.
3%, 5% female.
Right.
In the high paying training jobs for the thing. Okay, well, the state came down and they did the job, and we had a good look at it. What other areas would you say that the girls face, you know, were in that thing? I should say, what other areas do women face in the educational system in terms of...
I think one other important area is the area of athletics. And I don't think it's given enough attention because we think of it as sort of an after-school activity or, one period a day. But, in fact, they find that athletics trains you for dealing with all sorts of things beyond sports, like how to deal with competition. Uh-huh. It trains you to deal with looking at things spatially, which is very important when you study geometry. We can't even imagine all the ways in which it may help you in other aspects
That's
of your
a
life.
New one for me. How do you look at things spatially because you're in athletics?
Well, when you learn
you
how to throw
the team
a basketball,
and who's behind there?
No,
and who's
when you throw a basketball, there's an angle that you figure out, and then you begin to develop your awareness.
I never realized I was playing geometry when I was throwing a basketball. I was playing basketball when I was doing geometry.
Right.
No, either way. But in case, I absolutely
But it's
agree
very important
absolutely
in many ways.
Important.
And just for overall physical
right.
fitness. And
well, just relationship to other people. I
right.
mean, the colleagues, the camaraderie, the development of activities. And think of half the people who are just starting to jog now who would have been in pretty good condition if they had a lot more athletics, right?
Right. Right.
Do you think,
I think what happens is it starts in the elementary school level in terms of the athletics. By the time boys and girls get to junior high or high school, the girls have already weeded themselves out, most of them, mm-hmm. from athletic ability to participate.
Have weeded themselves?
No, the school has weeded them out.
All right.
From,
I want to be very careful because
the girls are weeted out. The girls
so
are
I must
weeded
say
out.
That the girls do drop out of certain things which they might have the occasion to go into.
See, I think it is a question a little bit of the girls weeding themselves
but
out, and I'll return to it.
Condition.
They don't choose certain things. The boys may exclude them. This is one of these situations, and the school doesn't directly intervene and encourage them.
Uh-huh.
And what the school may say to you is, well, if given the choice between jump rope and basketball, the girls will play jump rope. Why not let them do it? Mm-hmm. Well, fine, but they need to be encouraged to try the other as well. And if you look at a playground and watch what the boys and the girls are doing, you'll see it's very divided along sex lines.
You know, I've been down to the high schools in my area and even junior high schools and given a shot at it. Those girls are very good at basketball and hockey and volleyball and they were international teams and such. But they all tell me it took somebody who had a concern and interest. Mm-hmm. And by the way, in many cases, men coaches mm-hmm. who really want to encourage them, you know, and to help them. But they're also, you have to be aware, there are different physical problems and such. So if you're going to coach and encourage, you have to have that information. I don't think the schools bother with that, do they? How to do it, how to train for it and such. Alrighty. I think there's also, you spoke of role models mm-hmm. before. Mm-hmm. Now, within the school system, what kind of role models?
It's a very good question. One of the issues we've been attempting to grapple with is the fact that when young women are going into these vocational technical programs where uh-huh. women have been underrepresented, that often they're faced with an environment that's not user-friendly, if I can borrow the language from. And so what we have is an absence also of female teachers of uh-huh. technical subjects with whom young women might identify.
Right.
So one of the strategies, which I'm sure we'll talk about more later, is to try to increase the numbers of women who are teaching in the non-traditional areas as well.
Not only teachers, but what about people who are assistant principals and superintendents?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that kind of a role model, it's pretty discouraging not to see them coming through.
One of the things that's astounding about that is that there were actually, in the elementary school level at least, more women principals in the 30s and the 20s in this uh-huh. century than there are now. There's actually been a decrease in the number of women in supervisory positions, particularly on the elementary school uh-huh. level. The number of women superintendents of schools, for example, in the United States is minuscule. I mean, absolutely, overall in the United
really?
States. I think it's less than 1%.
Why do you think that decrease has taken place?
Well, I think that there have been more men who are going for those positions, and increasingly
they pay better.
They
get better benefits.
There is now really an old boys network in terms of moving men up into that, and I think men often consider staying in the classroom as not prestigious and not having enough status.
Uh-huh.
And
so they move on
the whole thing works to basically promote men into
the I know there
positions.
Was a period there, you know, when you had the real recession, depression, whatever you want to call it, and periods when the other jobs went out, and when the women were mainly the teachers and the principals and the lower schools and things like that, and this became a very desirable job. A lot of professionals in different fields who went into the vocational schools, they went from their regular fields into vocational because of the things that the teachers really fought for. I mean, nobody handed them the better jobs and the better pay and the better vacation. They really organized themselves and got it. But that's what's happening now, huh? That we're still predominantly male in the role model.
In the administrative
many,
level.
Many school districts feel at this point in time that women can't handle difficult schools, junior high schools, high schools, that a woman is not a strong enough leader, she's not tough enough, uh-huh. and they just exclude even the possibility of considering a woman for
Would
the
you
position.
Say, is that a fact or a myth?
That women aren't capable? I would say that it's a myth.
No, this is a very serious thing. I've heard it said, and I've heard it said, you know, the superintendents and principals are now chosen by school boards that are elected in the district. And we're facing a very serious problem there. And many of these people firmly believe in whether a man is fully capable of doing the job or not, and you may have a perfectly qualified woman, that they have the illusion. I say illusion because I've seen otherwise, but I get your mm-hmm. feeling about it. Is that an illusion that the woman is not qualified to handle a kid who comes up to the principal and...
I think it definitely is an illusion. I think it stems from a sort of narrow conception of what skills it takes to successfully run a school.
Uh-huh.
And the research shows that women are stronger as collaborative leaders. They tend to involve their staffs much more fully in the running of schools, and the sense, the feeling of morale is actually higher under uh-huh. the leadership of women than under the, say, traditionally. There's some important data on it, and we've been doing, you know, trying to communicate it to
uh-huh.
some of those
uh-huh.
selection
uh-huh.
committees.
Right.
But old ideas die hard.
It's hard to break them down, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And the men are fighting to maintain those positions. They're not exactly giving in gracefully to allow the women, you know, to move in and be competitive. Another thing that was also raised with me on the question of why are we dealing with sex equity or sexism as discrimination and bias, when some people say there's a much greater problem, that is bias on cultural minority level and such. Shouldn't we deal with everything all together, or shouldn't we hit the quote important problems first and then take this afterwards? Have you heard that kind of comments in your work?
Once in a while I hear that kind of comment. It's probably more often said after I leave the room than to me. And I think it's an issue that's important to think about, because I don't think that any other kinds of discrimination are any less serious or any less important.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, though, that we've learned from experience that to really resolve problems, you have to really focus your attention on them.
Mm-hmm.
And that there are problems that women experience just because they're women. And so we need to focus on the solutions they need because of those specific problems. And
we also must remember that many of the women, the girls that we're talking about, are Asian, Black, Hispanic, and they have the double burden of both race discrimination and sexism. They are the most discriminated against, and I think in talking about the situation of young women in schools, we are becoming their advocates as well, dealing with both forms of discrimination and the particular way that it affects them.
That's true. I know this has been raised with me, we want to fight the question of bias and discrimination in the schools. You need money, you need personnel, you need attention, you need all kinds of things. And people say to me, well, we just have so much. So what are we going to do? Take it from here and give it there, or take it from here and give it there? And I think experience has shown that we're not posing one against the other, that both need very serious attention. But unless you focus in on the question of what sexism means, first, there's no question of harassment of young girls in the schools or in the vocational school where they walked alone down the corridor and got all the remarks and saw peculiar cartoons on their lockers when they went in for the non-traditional job. Those things have to be addressed separately, and you have to focus in on them. And as you say, we're not taking away from the whole anti-discrimination and bias thing. In many cases, we're crossing over. So that's a problem there. I wonder, do I have a light on that thing? No, it's not. It's just very green. Okay.
I think, in fact, there's times when we end up dealing with many kinds of discrimination at the same time.
Right.
For instance, when we try and make textbooks include a broader variety of people, and we try and do that to eliminate sexism in the books, it's important to pay attention that we don't just add in women of one ethnic background. And I think that, in fact, we find that when you begin to address sexism, you often begin to address other problems as well. In the vocational schools, when we dealt with sexism, it improved the whole school.
It did.
Yes.
And attitudes in many ways. In other words, they became much more conscious of what discrimination was, what bias was, and it approached all people.
And in that way, it improved the school, and it also improved the school in the sense that they began to plan the programs better, and it just improved the overall quality of the school.
Well, let me just indicate that many of these things that we're talking about came out in the testimony at our first hearings back in 82, 83. And if anybody's interested, by the way, you can call my office, Councilwoman Friedlander, 566-1324, and you can get a copy of that first report because it laid out the problems. One of the things that we suggest in that report is that there be a sex equity task force to work with the Chancellor of the Board of Education. And interestingly enough, the Chancellor said yes. So we all got together, some very active people in the community work and in the issue work, people, some of whom you see here today, and he assigned people from his Board of Education to work with us, and that task force has succeeded, I found out in a hearing just this week, in making some real moves and some real changes. And when we come back, we'll be talking about that. For you who want to hear more about these things, you can ask us questions, and if you want to call in, you can call 505-6363, and we will discuss some of the problems with you when we get back into this thing. We'll talk about the task force, we'll talk about what's happening to the girls. See you soon.
Teachers mostly think that the boys have the ability to do more than girls, and they push us or encourage us to take, you know, the lighter subjects.
But they feel you, a female, you should be able to type.
We're subjected to do light things like light typing. You know, there are a lot of boys in accounting and stuff, but, you know, they call that manly kind of things.
Boys and girls, they both have to take and pass two terms of typing in the beginning.
In my opinion, it seems that a lot of women are more interested in office jobs than in, you know, electricians or stuff that you have to repair.
Because that's the role they've been stereotyped in for so long. Whatever you enjoy, you should go and do. You shouldn't, if you like to play basketball or sports, play basketball or sports. I feel the girls are getting a fair shake, because they're going for what they want, so.
Hi, we're back again, and I'm Miriam Friedlander, and I'm City Councilwoman Lower Manhattan and Chair of the Committee on Women. And we're talking today about the question, are the girls getting a fair break in the school education in our city? And I have some very fine guests here. You've been hearing them, and they have a lot more to tell us about it. And we have Walteen Grady from the school system, and she's Sex Equity Coordinator. Did you know we had such a person in our school system? One for a big system. How about that? Okay, and we have Lisa Syron, who is from FAIR. Say that title again.
FAIR is the Full Access and Rights to Education Coalition.
Well, that's a long title. I've been doing a lot of work on this whole thing. And then we have Dr. Sandy Weinbaum, who is?
Director of Access for Women.
Okay. So you can see people who are concerned. When we left, we talked about what we were going to do to begin to move on some of these problems and very difficult long-term problems that exist in our public school system. No, the girls were not getting the full benefits of education. As a matter of fact, they were getting turned around. But the whole question was being raised by the women themselves, who had to face some very serious problems later in life and found themselves really unequipped. Not only was the question of going to work, wanting to develop careers, having to go to work because of family problems, and then, of course, the recent period where we find many of them breaking with the family and having to assume the responsibility of families, children, and such. So, where do you start with that kind of building, training attitude? You know, can you make it? Can you deal with it? And no place is better to start than right down in the schools. That's where you get your first discussions, your first training, your first inspiration to move in some direction and what you're going to do. So let's talk about that task force. There's something unique about this task force, isn't there?
I think so. Like most things in New York City, it's a unique kind of endeavor.
We like New York.
One of the things that's unique about it is that it's been a partnership from the very beginning of community advocates and board of ed, people who are responsible for the various areas of concern that were raised by our discussions of the issue. And I think we found a genuinely good working relationship in dealing with the issue and in kind of grappling with the issue, because we recognize that it's bigger than either or of us, but that we have to work together.
Well, you've jumped about 1 year ahead now. We're all working together very well. But in the beginning, it wasn't easy. And I don't know how many of you have ever tried to move with a city department or a city agency. Well, Board of Ed's not exactly a city. It's kind of connected. And that was one of the first problems, I think, right? How to get the women of experience in the field working with the women of experience in the Board of Ed. And I think they all had the same desire and objectives. And everybody, well, what am I talking about, women of experience? We have a lot of men involved in this too, don't we?
We have quite a few.
We have quite a few who worked on this thing. Well, that was number one. We were able to get the men and women
Working together
in a board. And the chancellor, we got him to send a representative who was an active, forceful person to do that, and to designate people like yourself, right?
Right, sure.
And others to help continue the work and coordinate. You know, you have a tendency to protect your own turf. Weren't sure you wanted to look at the Board of Ed, you know, get the papers. Kind of the figures were secret, you know, we didn't want to embarrass them. After a while, we sort of realized we were all working for the same thing. It all came out on the table. What came out of your work in terms of the task force?
I worked primarily in the area of curriculum, of guidance services, and we were very concerned to make sure that the special needs that young women have in the guidance areas are addressed. I think a lot of times when we think about guidance, especially as related to work, we start talking about careers, and we start talking about people as if they're going to go out and have no other responsibilities in life. And that's especially not true for women.
Like they work three jobs?
Right, right.
They work in the home.
At least.
They work as mothers. and they work in the office.
Right. And it's very hard for adult women to learn how to coordinate all those things, no less a young woman to think about, well, if I'm going to go to school for this long, when can I have children? When will I get married? How do I decide which order these all go in? Uh-huh. Those are pretty hard questions.
That's right.
And I think that they have to start to be addressed in guidance services in schools. That's one area. And another area is just to start to introduce young women much earlier and in a much better way to what kinds of job opportunities there are and what the differences are in terms of salaries, and to learn that there are women in a lot of fields that we don't usually think of as okay for
and
women.
They can put on their work hat and pick up their stuff and stick it in the belt and go out and work like
right.
The others can. What other areas are we talking about?
Well, I've been concerned with curriculum and instruction.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And I want to backtrack for a minute in terms of talking about the problems in the school. I think there is, everybody knows, an explicit curriculum, math, science, reading, writing, and so
right.
forth, and the instructional materials that go with that.
Uh-huh.
That is the curriculum we have been concerned with. There's also what people in the field call the hidden curriculum, all the messages that girls and boys get all day long. You will be a good, it's fine to be a secretary, but you know, it's really tough to get into electronics for a girl. I mean, that's the, that they might hear from a guidance counselor.
Doesn't go on the blackboard.
Doesn't go on the blackboard. That sometimes is more powerful and important than the explicit
uh-huh.
curriculum.
Uh-huh.
And the two, of course, are related. But what I have been dealing with on the task force is the explicit curriculum, what is actually taught, and the materials that are used to teach it. And we started with a look at the materials, and we asked, well, just for starters, how are materials approved? How does a textbook get approved? How does a film get approved? How does a piece of software for the computer get approved?
Good questions. Okay, we now have a committee. Five committees were established, weren't
mm-hmm.
they?
Well, right.
What were the five of them?
Vocational education, guidance, curriculum and instruction, administrative supervisory employment,
uh-huh.
and athletics.
Athletics. Mm-hmm. Okay. And from what I can see, there were people both from the Board of Education and the people from the community groups that working on each committee. Is that it?
Yes.
Okay. Maybe we can get sort of an idea of where they've started to move. Let's see, did they really do something? You know, I hate to use a lot of talk and a lot of words and then walk away from it and nothing happens. So let's get it. You, your group originally worked with the vocational
right.
ed problems.
Right.
Who followed up on that? Who was chairing that committee?
Rhoda Schulzinger, actually,
yes,
from
FAIR. FAIR. But can you give us an idea of what you thought was accomplished there since she's not here today?
Well, I think that FAIR really contributed a comprehensive list of recommendations to implement,
right.
Including increasing the support systems for young women in the schools, speeding up our progress on getting the facilities in place that would make schools a comfortable place for young women. There were a whole variety of things. FAIR also encouraged us to go out into the schools and provide more technical assistance and training for staffs so that they were better prepared to accept these young women.
Uh-huh.
Many of our teachers had taught for many years basically to one sex, and so it's been an adjustment for them.
That's very interesting. A guy who was teaching carpentry to men now had to teach it to young women.
Exactly.
When I went to schools for our study, one of the things that some male shop teachers told me is they had to think about the language they used and the examples they used, and they had to change things now that they had girls in their classes. So it affected it in a very dramatic way, and I think one of the best strategies that the Board of Education utilized to address that problem is they created a new position in those vocational high schools, and that person is called the Sex Equity Coordinator. And they work with the young women in those schools to help the transition into the school, to help.
Is there, what, one or two in the high school?
There's one in each of the vocational high schools.
One now in every vocational high school.
Yeah.
That is a major change. Mm-hmm. In other words, if a young woman has a problem or is interested, she can reach the sex equity coordinator in the school.
Yes, right. The sex equity coordinator acts as an ombudsperson to hear concerns, to provide support,
that's
and
right.
to act as a sort of go-between.
Everybody should know that. You should know that young women are being encouraged now. Is there an actual shift? By the way, I've been forgetting to tell our audience, there is a phone here if you do want to ask about any of these problems. It's 505-6363, and we'd be happy to talk to you about it. Okay, what were you telling me?
Well, the role of the sex equity coordinator is to act as a resource both to the non-traditional student and to the staff who might need assistance in working with those students.
Okay, I can see one of the instructors might have a problem on how to deal with some of the young women who walk in and because they're a little wary and stuff, might walk in with a chip on their shoulder, right? Mm.
Well, the problems can be very serious. The problems can be questions of sexual harassment, for example.
Uh-huh.
And that, of course, becomes a very serious issue of
right.
how one is going to deal with that within the school system. Now, of course, it is against the law, but of course there are, as in all sexual harassment issues, difficulties defining exactly what sexual harassment is. I think the person who is receiving it has no difficulty defining it, but the people giving it out may say, well, we were just teasing
you,
you know, come on, you don't can't take a joke,
uh-huh.
and yet it can be overwhelmingly intimidating for a young woman who is already taken this enormous pioneering step to even be there, and now she's surrounded by people who...
So at least we've supplied that kind of a sex coordinator, somebody she can talk to, somebody they can refer to, a teacher can come to help solve some of the questions or define the questions and such. I think this is a major accomplishment. Let's just say that one in the hearing, what we did find was that we need more of those in the junior highs and the public school system. So it's not just in the vocational school. So we're looking forward to getting that kind of increase in people working in that field.
I think one of the problems is that when you say sex equity to people, they don't have the vaguest idea what you're talking about.
I agree. That's what I say.
And I think that's why you need a person whose sole focus is that, who will begin to... Sometimes people aren't really opposed to it. They just don't really realize there's a problem or what to do about it.
How about those who say, well, let's give them a shot to learn better. You know, give those male teachers a chance to get used to the idea. Give the young men a chance to, you know, get sense of it before we impose on them. Have you gotten that kind of a thing?
I don't think that we've ever gotten that. I think it's been clear from the beginning that as public school educators, our mandate is to serve our students.
Well, we had a mandate in our Constitution in relation to minority people, too, but we didn't exactly carry it out until they were forced to do it.
Mm-hmm.
We had the law, but then we had to go to the Supreme Court to enforce the law,
that's
right?
That's true.
So I don't think being there as a mandate is exactly any guarantee.
But
that you're
I do have to insist that during the time that I've worked with educators, that's one comment I haven't heard. I've heard other comments.
Yeah.
I mean, I've heard concerns about changes and uneasiness about maybe you're trying to make things different from the way they've ever been before.
Aren't you rushing it a little bit? You never heard
sometimes
that?
Sometimes you hear that.
That's what I'm talking about.
And again,
about.
When you talk about the issues of equity crossing many lines, the
right.
same arguments that are used against
that's
equity
right.
on the basis
okay.
of race
well,
are used for
let's go to some of the other fields now. You were talking about your own committee. You chair the committee on what?
On guidance.
Uh-huh.
In
and
one
what
of
have you suggested and what has been done?
Well, one of the things that we suggested was that we begin to look at the attitudes that guidance counselors bring to the guidance situation, what
uh-huh.
Sandy called the hidden curriculum. And we recommended that the guidance department conduct a self-evaluation. They handed out a survey to all guidance counselors in the community school districts and in the high schools.
Yeah.
And those guidance counselors had to look at their own attitudes about women and men and what was appropriate for boys to do and girls to do. And they're going to use those surveys, the results of that survey, to start helping to educate guidance counselors.
I see. And you expect frank and full answers on your survey?
Well,
you know, it's surprising. I've had a chance to review some of those, actually, and on the basis of them have already conducted a couple of workshops.
Oh.
And I guess anonymity is a great source of protection. And so I think that perhaps makes people feel a little more comfortable about.
And you think that survey is going to bring in the basis for dealing with the question with your guidance?
Sure. I've encountered supervisors who are genuinely amazed to find the gaps exist. I mean, until you have a way of concretizing the issue, it's very difficult to decide on a strategy to deal with it.
And what kind of conferences are you developing, or
well,
we've
been doing workshops.
Workshops?
A male colleague and I go together because, after all, we're talking about sex equity.
Uh-huh.
And the most popular workshop seems to be on sex equity awareness in career education.
Interesting. You're doing it with the teachers and with the guidance counselors?
Yeah.
Are you going into the school
districts? Yes.
In other words, if anybody in the school district or any parent or any teacher feels you have need for that in their place, they can call you.
All
at the
they have to
it?
Do is call the Office of Equal Opportunity.
The Office of Equal Opportunity. There is such a place down on Livingston Street, 110 Livingston, and ask for help.
Mm-hmm. And let me give the number,
please,
if I may.
Please do.
It's
718-796-8100. So you see, there are pockets of help here that we're beginning to develop. Sandy, tell us about your committee. What is it that you work with on that?
Well, we started with, as I said before, the question of the kinds of materials that we use to instruct students.
Uh-huh.
And there is an approved list of every book that's purchased, every film that's purchased, and so forth, must be on an approved list. So what are the criteria that are used to approve materials?
Yeah.
Have they in the past included the question of sex equity in their criteria? Now, they have included it, but they have not really outlined what that means, nor have they instructed the people reviewing these materials in what it means. So for us, the issue was to develop really comprehensive guidelines in equity issues across the board that would deal with racism, with sexism, with bias based on disability stereotyping, and to develop a comprehensive set of guidelines, and then to instruct the people both within the central board who review materials and on the district
level.
Well,
what have you done on it now?
So far, we're at the point of, first of all, a small amount of money was allocated as a result of our recommendation.
That's nice.
To appoint,
must be important if they part with some money on that.
A little bit of money. To appoint some consultants who are experts in these equity areas.
Oh, really?
And they have developed the guidelines. At this point, those guidelines need to be reviewed by a number of bodies, and then the question will be to really use them to train people who will be reviewing materials.
And the people who make these decisions on the books and the
they're usually experts in their particular discipline. They're not equity experts, and that's why.
I mean, if you're an expert in math, you're not an expert in.
But do they look to see whether the math examples, in fact?
Yeah, Mary has three pancakes and John has four, four hammers,
exactly.
You know, and which.
Or do they have illustrations of famous women mathematicians scattered around the textbook
that
you get on the higher levels?
That was one of the questions that was raised at the hearing. Talk about role models, we're back there again. How many people know that women have contributed to the history of this country? It's a difficult thing to know. If you look at the history books, maybe you'll find one, two women. Maybe on History Week, Women's History Week, March?
Well, I once did a study of the representation of women in U.S. history textbooks.
Yeah.
And on average, your 700-page textbook, I'm talking about the high school level now, has about 14 pages devoted to women.
14 pages to women.
And now I'm talking about textbooks that have been written in the last, let's say, 5 years, maybe 20 pages devoted to women.
So we have a long way to go.
We have a long way to go.
All right. One of the things I suggested at the hearing is that instead of having Women's History Week, you might have Women's History Month and a Women's History Project every month. I bet you could find 12 women that you could deal with through the year, huh?
I think we could come up with 12.
Some more than that, huh?
Probably in about 2 seconds.
Okay, in about 2 seconds. We could come All right. Up but there are. They're fantastic histories of what women have done, particularly in where there have been tremendous amounts of repression and poverty and feeling. They have been the leaders in the whole social service field in housing for the majority of people. The women in the churches that have maintained, you know, the social life and the connections and stuff. So someday we're going to dig all of that out. Okay, what's our other committee?
Let's see, athletics.
Athletics.
Have we discussed athletics?
Okay, no. What were some of the questions that we thought we had to hit at there?
Well, the question of the curriculum at the elementary school level.
Right. What's the difference? How do they treat boys and how do they treat girls in the athletics?
We've just begun our discussions of that, but following the patterns that we've discussed in the other areas, uh-huh. the stereotypes of boys as strong and needing to have that motor development that somehow young women don't need because, after all, we're just going to sit and fold our hands and not work hard.
It's hard work having a baby.
Right.
They give all kinds of athletic approaches to it these days. Right?
Another issue that's coming out, I think, is the fact that you need physical development in order to do a number of the non-traditional jobs that we're talking
That's
about.
Right.
So you have a link there between athletics and vocational education.
We just had a hearing with all the women in the uniformed services in the city of New York. Mm-hmm. And they sure needed athletics to get into those things. And they also had to be recognized with physical differences.
Right.
You know, they had strengths in their hip while the men had strength in their shoulder. But they could both do the job.
Well, that actually has been one of the critical issues that's raised during workshops, is the concern about women going into the uniformed
services.
Can they
carry a 200-pound
right.
dummy down the fire escape?
Can they carry my colleague if they're trapped?
If they're trapped or anything of that sort. And what they found was that for all the work that had to be done, the women were capable of handling the job. And a lot of the work was brain work, you know, make decisions what to do and when to do, fully capable of doing that. It's fantastic. The women just went through a training program to first women getting into the sanitation department. Yes, they could haul the cans, you know. They just had to be given a shot at it. And here again, we have the higher paying skilled jobs and the orientation that girls were not supposed to break in or capable of doing it. And here we have the myth of ability to do the job that has to be broken down. Same thing in athletics in the schools, right?
Sure. Sure. The concern is there. We're recognizing that the resources
they don't
very
have
often
the coaches.
Right.
They're not given the money for that. They're not given the time for practicing teamwork and things like that.
There's a concern about access to facilities and practice time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Very much so. Part of the issue is whether there are differences in each community school district as to whether there's a physical education program.
Some have and some don't.
Some have and some don't. And again, it's tied to the age of the various buildings.
Isn't this a program that should be mandated or is mandated in the Board of Ed?
There is no state
regulation
law governing physical education. We've been doing some investigating of that as part of the work of this
So
group.
Maybe we need a state law on that. I mean, with the new revelation that physical work and physical exercise is a big basic part of living longer, being healthier, having a healthier heart and all of that, aren't we depriving young girls of that basic foundation of a good body and health if we deprive them of that?
Certainly.
Hey, we have to look into that, right? A law in that thing. What are we doing on the question of women supervisors, you know, principals, administrators? What's happening on that program?
Well, yeah? at this point, the Board of Education does review the applicant pools when people apply for jobs, and if not a sufficient number of women have applied, offices who are hiring are directed to go back and re-announce positions so that on that level there is activity. We would like to do more to encourage more women to apply, because what we're finding is that we have more women actually appointed, mm-hmm. a larger percentage appointed than are part of the applicant pool. So we want to change, we want to turn that around so we have many, many more women applying.
All righty. So if you're interested in that kind of work and that kind of job and you want to move up, let's call in. Let's find out whether the opportunities are there. Are they getting posted and publicized? And are you working with the school boards to help train them to accept and receive and encourage
sure.
women in that?
Sure. Last June, when the newly elected board members came down for an orientation, we did a session on the strengths of the female administrator and raised our concerns about the fact that we think that selection committees don't recognize the range of skills that women have to offer as leaders.
Uh-huh. Were they surprised?
Some were. In fact, a number of them came up to me afterwards and asked if we could do more in their districts, and we're available to do that.
How about that? All righty.
That's great.
I hadn't heard about that one, had you?
No, but I was going to mention another outcome of the task force, which is that there will be a conference for mm-hmm. women administrators to encourage them to apply and to kind of show them the ropes. There will be role models there. They'll talk about the barriers, how to cut through them, how to prepare, and so forth.
Uh-huh,
I think
uh-huh.
some women are discouraged from even applying. They think it's an old boys network and they're not going to be able to break into it. So this is to do exactly what Walteen was saying, which is to enlarge the applicant pool to start out with. I think the one thing that has been postponed and many of us feel is necessary is to do research on what really is happening. How mm-hmm. many women have applied or considered
and been discouraged.
And been discouraged. Yeah. What is really happening? Yeah. I think we need a little bit more research.
Well, somebody came up to me after the hearing and said, hey, you know, you sound pretty good. You're starting to break through. But in my district, anything I want or anything I suggest, I've got a sexist sitting up there, and he has the right to say I can have it or not have it, you know. How do I get past him, you know? And these are some of the problems still facing us in the schools, that there's a whole barrier there that we still have to break through. It seems to me that a lot has been done to begin to deal with. But the most important thing is for people to know, one, it does exist in the public school, and secondly, we are beginning to tackle it. Thirdly, there's a place you can call and ask for help. Tell the facts. Let's know what's going on. And there are people in the area, the combination of the community people and the Board of Ed people, who can come down and deal with your specific problem, whether it's a youngster's problem, whether it's a teacher's problem, whether it's an administrator's problem, whether it's curriculum, whatever it is. We would welcome, you know, people coming in and talking about it and letting us know. Yes, there is, the girls are still not getting a fair break, but at least there's a consciousness of it. Would you say there's a new awareness of what's going on here?
I think there is in Central Board. I don't think at the district level.
We haven't broken down at district level. We need help on that.
Yeah.
I agree. I think we have to need more help on district level. What's your feeling, quickly?
I think at the district level, and I think in every single high school. I mean, for it to filter all the way down into the classroom is a long process.
Okay. Do you think we ought to begin to talk to the students themselves directly?
Sure.
Yeah.
In fact,
we
one
are.
Of the things that we're suggesting is a public campaign, a media campaign, to help young women become more aware of their opportunities.
Okay, an educational campaign, a media campaign. Hey, come, let's talk. Let's talk about the problem, and let's see what we can do to hit it. Walteen, one brief word?
We're working at it, and we need public support and input, and we welcome calls and suggestions and recommendations and energy.
Uh-huh.
We can use all of that.
Okay. I think we are recognizing the problem. I think we are beginning to tackle them. Our big fight is still ahead. Education, consciousness, changing of programs, and the development. We're encouraged. I hope you are. Thank you. I'm Miriam Friedlander, City Councilwoman, Lower Manhattan. I want to thank my guests, Sandy, Walteen, Lisa. Good night. Have a good evening.
Teachers mostly think that the boys have the ability to do more than girls, and we're, you know, they push us or encourage us to take, you know, the lighter subjects.
But they feel you, a female, you should be able to type.
We're subjected to do light things like light typing. You know, there are a lot of boys in accounting and stuff, but, you know, they call that manly kind of things.
Boys and girls, they both have to take and pass two terms of typing in the beginning.
In my opinion, it seems that a lot of women are more interested in office jobs than in, you know, electricians or stuff that you have to repair.
Because that's the role they've been stereotyped in for so long.
Whatever you enjoy, you should go and do. You shouldn't, if you like to play basketball or sports, play basketball or sports.
I feel the girls are getting a fair shake, yeah. Because they're going, you know, going for what they want, so.